office at 230 Ash Street for distribution to the community TV stations in Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. I've always wondered why we can't stream on the web apart from the cable channels, but
Yeah, that's a good point.
That's just an aside. Perhaps we can take that up next time. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair. I don't believe we're going to have anybody here, but if there were, I would say once recognized by the chair, please give your name and address and do that prior to speaking. It's the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. So we, Dave, you will be the board secretary.
I would be happy to do it. Thank you.
Dennis, welcome from the CAM. It mentions that Karen or Mark might be here from FinCom, but they're not here. So we can carry on. I don't think there's public comment, right?
Not appearing.
Do we have a report from the CAB or from the CAB rep, Dave? We just had a meeting.
Yeah, we just had a meeting. Dennis, I missed the opening part, but I think we'll be hearing that from Hamid about the real estate piece, right?
Yeah, we talked a little bit about Kathleen gave us an update on, I know Colin gave us an update on, you know, looking for the land for the substation. Nothing much new there. Hamid gave us a reliability update. We talked about the upcoming budget and scheduling meeting, meeting to do everything one night for October. That's about it.
Okay. We have no liaisons here, right?
No. Not that I see.
Okay. Public comment, I think we covered that already, so we can move on. Yeah, so Dave, there is a moment here if you just add anything to Dennis's.
No, I don't think so. I'm good.
To Dennis's question, when is the budget? When is the board going to get the budget? Our board.
The budget is going out September 30th.
Okay. Next week.
And we discussed it with the CAB earlier. We're looking at October 23rd for the CAB meeting. And because they have up to 30 days to review them. And then the board has until actually it gets implemented January 1st. So talk about the schedule for that. Hoping to do it in the same night, similar to not the CAB and the board, but the capital and the expense as one story in one night. Because I think it was very successful last year.
Sounds good. So we have an action item on approving the minutes from the April 24 meeting.
Move that the commission approve the meeting minutes of April 24th, 2019, on the recommendation of general manager.
Second.
Second.
All in favor? Motion passes 4-0. And Colleen, your report.
Okay.
Yeah, I should have mentioned that John is not here. John Stempak is traveling and could not be here tonight. That's why the vote is 4-0.
But he will be assigned all tasks later on that we decide.
Anybody else smell like exhaust or something?
Like something, rather, yeah.
Okay.
Anybody else?
If it gets any worse, I'll call facilities.
Okay.
But I can smell something. It just smells like a little bit like exhaust or something.
Okay.
Gas truck parked out by one of the intakes.
Maybe. Okay, so first item is update on the report regarding the payment Town of Reading. So I met with Energy New England on Monday, this past Monday, and what we did is we went over all of the input variables to make sure that all of the financials and everything that we had provided to them originally were all in order, and that all of that data was accurate. Because we're issuing the budget pretty much next week, we're going to send that down as well, and that they are prepared to come and make a presentation for the October board meeting. We get the draft before that, and I can share it with the commissioners, and they can do either October or November. I guess you just probably want to decide how you want to do that logistically, if you want to get it to review it, and then we have a public meeting, and then a follow-up public meeting, however you want to do it, but we have to fit the budget in there in order for that to be approved.
Well, we might need to have another meeting in October to do all these things. Because once that's, again, maybe actually if you could back up for anybody who's maybe watching who doesn't know what Energy New England is or what this study is, like, just as if nobody's ever heard of this. What is it? What is the study about? Who is Energy New England? Walk the viewer through that.
So the study was actually done by myself originally.
Yep.
That looked at the financials projections, and it was a study that I did to my commissioners looking at the operating income in the future. Should we continue in the direction of sales flat or decreasing? With an increasing town of Reading payment showed a potential convergence in the future. So just, with fiduciary duty, just letting everyone know that we needed to keep an eye on this. And then I did a full study on that, and we presented that back late last year, I suppose, went over those details, and I was asked to get an update to my study and by a third party. Checked into a few people, electric utility industry and gathering data and stuff that you want to use from comparisons. It's not something that's relatively easy to get. So we asked Energy New England if they were able to perform that study for us, and they agreed. And they've been working on it. They're trying to, put together pieces. We're obviously given all of the input as far as just the financials, the budgeting material, and everything that they need to know, historical numbers and stuff like that, just making sure that all of that is accurate so that they can produce their draft
And
document.
What is the date that we will have the report?
I don't have an absolute firm date. I just know that the draft will be out, and then they said they'd be prepared to present at the October meeting.
Okay, thank you.
So Colleen, so
I need to send them the budget.
Yep.
They've asked for an update because they have the last set of financials, the audited financials, but then they wanted to look at the capital outlay because that all gets inputted in.
Mm-hmm.
So while they have last year's,
yep.
I wanted to give them the most updated information. So we're going to send that out next week. Send it to you. We send it to E&E. We send it to the CAB for review, and we can go from there. So I'm hoping that they'll give us a draft at least a week before the meeting, so that we can review it.
Okay, I'm a little confused. So we have a couple of things. We have the RMLD budget.
Yes.
And we have the study.
Right.
Are we talking about the town seeing the budget?
E&E is going to send me a draft of their study.
Right.
And I'm going to send it to you.
Right.
And then they're going to come in and present the study to you at the October meeting. Or they're prepared to do it at the October meeting.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
But then how does that relate to the discussion on the budget?
I just said that whatever you think is going to happen with the study, if you think it's going to be presented and there's going to be a vote or something's going to happen in October that night, or whether or not you'll take the presentation, think about it, and discuss it in November, all I'm saying is we have to fit the budget in there as well at some point. That's what I'm saying.
It's fitting the budget into the schedule, not budgeting for whatever the study outcomes are.
I just don't know if you're going to be in a position to think about it and take a vote of anything in October, and you may want to...
I would think November would be safer. I'm all for getting it done, but it's something we don't want to do twice, and I think we want to be, reflective on it, so...
Yeah, we need to get input from the stakeholders and the town of Reading and everybody in the CAB, so certainly it's going to take some months to go through and have a proper, process.
But we at least
have a starting point where we're going to have a study with kind of looking at our numbers and giving us some thoughts about what the proper levels should be or could be, or what the impacts of different levels of payment are in terms of rates or in terms of our operations.
But I think the October schedule makes sense, I think, the way you offered it.
Yeah.
Okay.
But getting the study and knowing that there's a study in hand and a presentation in public in October is great, and then that's a good starting point, and we go from there through a review process with ourselves and with the town and the county.
I think, Mr. Chair, yep. we need to make sure we get the budget and the draft in advance.
And that, too. So I was talking about the payment study, but quite right.
Yeah.
A separate track. Yeah, it's related in the sense that T&E wants to see the budget to help
right.
them
mm-hmm.
with the study. But as a separate and distinct thing, the board needs the budget so we can have a chance to look at it and maybe we should convene a meeting right after we get it just to talk about the budget and any feedback on the budget before it just comes up for a vote.
Right.
So we may need two meetings, in October for these reasons.
Right, because you may get the presentation from E&E and ask them to take it back and do some more analysis or try these scenarios or whatever. You don't know what's...
Right, but we want to do that in a public session. So whatever their draft is going to be a public document because it's coming to all of us. That
Correct.
Makes it a public document. We will then release it, and we'll have a meeting at which we and others can comment on it. This is how, that's just the right process. So, and I expect there'll be, some months of discussion in the community about it until we come to the right answer. But when stuff comes to us, it's a public document at that point. That's just how it is.
Yep.
It's a public document, but I'd like to just make sure that we can have enough time for us to do our homework on the study.
For sure.
Right.
Yep.
And it may be that, if we see something in there that we think is wrong, you may not have the October meeting.
Well,
I think
we've got
to cross that bridge when we get to it.
Right, but what we can't do is get a study and be vetting it offline without it being a public process. That we can't.
I agree with that.
I
need to, I'm not hoping to come in as the media, the night of the meeting and have to put it
in. That's, it would be nice to have it ahead of time, but
right.
when we get the study, it's a public document.
So I guess, and I don't know the technicalities of it, but the only thing I would say is, and not having experience with who's doing the report, the other side of that is, this is hypothetical, so you get a report that's filled with errors and omissions, it's a public document, there's consternation in the whole town and towns over. So I don't propose to say that what you said is wrong, but I guess there's probably a point where you at least say, as a board, we don't see anything that's wrong in here. It's one thing to say we agree or disagree. It's another thing to say, well, this is these numbers are all wrong. They weren't calculated. You know what I'm saying? So do we want to really open that up to the town without having done?
I mean, the answer is that when we get a report, it's a public document. So if that's all.
It's a draft for review.
I'll put the question into the state about what is what's up.
You know where I'm coming from.
I do.
It's a public document once it gets to the full commission.
Correct.
If the chair looks at it in advance as, without it coming to the full commission, the chair could do that.
All of this is hypothetical because we don't have a report.
Right, we don't have a report. Mm-hmm.
We've been
right.
No, but I would just caution us. This has been a very important subject for a very long time,
right.
And I think we would do a disservice to all the stakeholders if something got served up and it was 50% inaccurate for whatever the reasons.
Yeah, I have more faith in Colleen that we're not going to get reports.
No, but it's not. I'm saying it's.
I do. I think we all want to do the right thing, which is to get the report done and have the proper process.
Exactly. Let's get the report first.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So anything else to discuss other than that matter from your report?
On that?
Yeah, just from your general manager's report, what we just discussed.
Just a reminder that the first week of October is Public Power Appreciation Week. So on the 10th, we'll be having our open house, and because we're turning 125 years old, so the open house is usually 3 to 6, so from 5 to 6, we're probably going to have a little birthday party.
Oh,
so,
nice.
There you go. Great. Exciting. I'd like to say, can I say?
Yep.
I don't think this place looks a day older than 120 years old. So, just pass along that compliment to RMLD.
First off, there's no truth to the rumor. I've been here all that time. I do have a question, though, John mentioned. Where are we on the 20-year agreement at this point? Where does that stand now?
We sent out the notification. There's a process that Kathleen Ryback is following in order to get it. So there's letters that I had to produce, and then they get sent out. So she's working all of that and making sure that it's mindful for the time frames and time limits that are in the 20-year agreement to be sent out. So that is in process.
Okay.
They have to – so the letter that got sent out basically says that they have to take a vote, and in certain towns it's their selectmen that voted, and in other towns it's a different – each town does it a little bit differently. So they have to do it in a certain amount of time to get it back before it expires next June.
Okay.
It's 180 days, I think, from the expiration date. So she's got it all timed, and the letters are going out or have gone out because I wrote the letter a couple weeks ago. So she may be holding it for perfect timing, so but it's all set to go.
Okay.
Thank you.
Colleen, or do you want to move on to Chuck?
Chuck, you're on.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, Chuck.
First half of my report will be saying boring, everything's wonderful in power supply activity.
We like boring.
Okay, well, that's unfortunate because the second half is going to be really exciting.
The second half.
Edge of the seat, nail biting. So we're looking at where we are overall with purchase power. And we are running right about on budget for the summer, but because of earlier portions of the year, we're still running with costs below expectations. As we step through, this is the total purchase power. We'll see on the next slide. I believe it's energy. Energy costs have tracked fairly well, and that is 80% of our power supply budget, but we're still tracking with a positive differential, actual cost coming in below budget. So, if we take a look, capacity costs, since they're set on a prior year's peak and we know what the price is, that's usually a pretty stable budget. The difference has more to do with ISO corrections on capacity charges than anything else. And on the transmission, what we're seeing there, a little bit different, but since we turned on the batteries and the generator, we have been accruing some transmission savings. The reason it doesn't show up on the capacity curve is that we're working off of last year's results. So we don't expect that to change. That will show up starting next May. And again, it will track based on what we were able to save. So it doesn't show up as clearly as the transmission savings do. But what you're seeing is the impact of having a generator and a battery energy storage system on our power supply portfolio costs. So, next, please.
Can you just go back?
Yes, sir.
Can you go back one slide?
I can. There we go.
So, for example, in July, we saved $400,000 versus what we had in our budget. So the expenditures were 1.2 rather than 1.6.
Yes.
And that's so 400 grand is what RMLD saved in a month from having the generator and the battery.
Yes.
That's amazing. what it, can you just remind us what did these facilities cost?
What do they cost?
Yeah, what did it cost for us to put them in?
Typically, batteries and generators cost approximately $1 million per megawatt.
Okay.
So if you got a 2-point.
Okay. So we're making a payment of $50,000 a month to pay off.
And keep in mind, this is comparing budget to actuals. So
right, it's not the actual savings. Right. But still, presumably the budget was based on actual experience in previous years, right? So, that's great. That's awesome.
Yeah.
It's impressive.
You have him identify himself? I don't think we've been him before.
Yeah, who is that guy?
Yeah.
Yes.
Who is that?
That masked man. I have met Zach. I just forgot.
I apologize.
It's okay.
Okay.
Zach, thank you for that. Appreciate it.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's great. It's good to just, and then we're seeing similar numbers each month over the summer. And, anyway, it's great. It's great to see. It's going to help a lot.
Yeah, that's
thank
good
you.
Work.
And just, you know, RMLD has the biggest battery in the state, am I wrong, or among municipal
you're
light
correct.
Plants. There are bigger ones owned by the IOUs or maybe industrial, but we're the biggest. Is any bigger
biggest
one?
Muni battery.
Are there other munis with similar size scale coming in?
No. Well, Taunton has a, it's not 5 megawatts, is it?
Not as of our inaugural, because DOER came in and said that we were the,
yeah.
As of our inaugural, the largest project. We haven't kept track. I hate to bear bad news to the commission, so I don't
please.
Want to know. Somebody with a bigger battery has shown up, you know.
Well, I know Taunton got an ACES grant as well for their battery, but I'm not exactly sure the size of it. It's
right.
Not quite as big as the Reading.
And what's the amount that's being either stored or generated or both at any one time during these periods? What's the combined?
We generally hold the battery around 10%, so that would be 1 megawatt hour.
Okay.
The total storage capability of the batteries is 10 megawatt hours. We can discharge at a rate of 5 megawatts.
Five, right.
So
we for 2 hours.
The maximum would be 2 hours at 5.
Right.
If we need to cover a larger window, say 4 hours, we dispatch at 2.5 per hour for the 4 hours. Or we can do 3.333333.
Anybody wanting to guess how many hours that would be for? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Chuck, you want to explain the answer? How many hours would
it
that
it should be pretty close to 3.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But not exactly, because it's 3.333.
Yes.
Anyway, the point is, You're releasing at a megawatt when you do it. Have you turned it up higher than that?
No, we store normally,
right.
Just to keep the battery warm, if you will, at a megawatt.
Right.
When we know that we're going to have an event the next day,
yep.
We ramp it up to 50%.
Yep.
Then in the afternoon prior to the event, we take it up. Well, in the morning we take it to 80, in the afternoon we take it to 100.
Okay.
And then we discharge it down.
But what is the rate at which you discharge? Is it throwing out a megawatt or 2 megawatts, or it depends?
We can throw out up to 5.
But what are you doing in practice?
We've been doing 3.3 to 5.
Okay. So
you've either called a 3-hour or a 2-hour.
So you're gambling on hitting the exact hour.
Well,
but
the reason that we extended is so that we don't gamble, but yes.
Mr. Chairman. Can we have Zach come up and sit next to
sure.
Chuck, because I think he'd like to add some important information.
Please.
And he can panel with Chuck. And
it's good. Plus, he can be on TV.
Wait,
yes.
Can you get up here because the mic's live?
So, Zach, why don't you identify yourself? And
yep.
Per proper procedure, as outlined at the beginning of the meeting, we ask for your name to be stated.
Absolutely. Zach Borden, Senior Power Supply Analyst.
Okay.
So the transmission bill is based on the 1 CP, so it's a 1-hour peak.
Yep.
That they look at. But to bring accuracy, we're right now running usually based on a call, which is usually 3 hours.
Right.
So we'll do that 3.33 for 3 hours.
Because you don't know which one it's going
to
be.
Yeah, but our team's working on analyzing how to get that more accurate,
yep.
To get that narrowed down to a 2-hour
yeah.
or potentially 1-hour window.
Okay.
So we can get maximum discharge.
Okay. And then what's the generator? So that's the battery, but then what is the generator adding to that?
The generator is a 2.5 megawatt generator. It can run Hamid, correct me, is it 90%?
95%.
95% of 2.5 megawatts, but it's natural gas fired, it's continuous feed through the duration of an event.
Right. So the takeaway that I think is important here, and it loops back to the conversation we were just having about RMLD's financial health, our ability and desire to make as big a payment as we can, also hinges on the engineering practices that are being implemented, which are being done very well, but also what the community does, and that includes our towns. So right now you see we're ballparking it. Let's say we're able to throw out 4 or 5 megawatts from the battery and the generator. And on a peak day, what are we doing, 150 megawatts? So this is like 3% of your load you're able to, or 2.5%. So if everybody else was able to throw another 2.5% on the peak when those emails go out, which are being done very professionally lately and very regularly and very pithy in what they say, if people listen to those and act on them and can do another 3 megawatts, there's another 400,000 a month, maybe. Maybe it's less, but there's hundreds of thousands of dollars of savings that can be achieved if people do what, you know, and heed these warnings. Just want to keep driving that home.
That's an excellent point. To be clear and to be fair,
yeah,
the savings that you're seeing up here also includes the participation impacts
right.
of our largest customers
yes.
who are participating in the peak management program.
Thank you for that reminder. And how much is that adding?
I don't have the numbers from that. I believe we have 10 to 12 customers that have been participating in each event.
And does that add up to the same magnitude of the generator and the battery, or is it less or more?
It does not yet.
It's like half of that, or to a first approximation? I'm just trying to get a sense of, like, I'm trying to communicate to people how important and what the magnitude of the dollar savings is to the utility and the ratepayer and all those benefits to the town payment and everything else when people do this stuff.
Can I make a suggestion,
yeah.
Dave?
Please.
How about at the next meeting,
right.
Chuck breaks it down again,
fine.
And we can go through the savings by
yep.
class?
Okay,
and
yep.
break it down.
Because we know what the transmission rate is, and we can take that and run different scenarios and provide those output savings numbers.
Okay.
We're reaching the end of what we consider to be the summer peak period.
Correct.
Usually runs June 15th through September 15th. So at the conclusion of this, we go back and we look for each of the transmission peaks during the summer.
Yep.
What we had for customer participation. We can also look on the capacity peak to see what customer participation was. So we would be able to give you an impact assessment
right.
for capacity and transmission from those customers who participated. Now, transmission continues to participate the peak management through the rest of the year.
Right.
But we do focus the capacity portion and the residential and commercial participation there on the summer period. But we'll have a full impact assessment.
Okay.
Zach will have a full impact assessment.
Zach will have it. When will you have that ready, Zach?
Whenever we need it.
Okay, great.
About 10 minutes?
Yeah, I should go and run
yeah.
those down.
Well, you know, this is awesome, and I think we just got to keep communicating out what the magnitude of these things are, because I think it's not through no fault of our own, because we are pushing out this data and we are doing all these things. A lot of people just don't get it, because I look around and I see people not heeding the warnings and not heeding the things, and so, you know, enough said.
Yeah. Something that's interesting that Chuck said is he said energy is around 80% of our costs, whereas capacity and transmission are around 20%. But historically, that wasn't the case. Historically, you know, those percentages were lower for capacity and transmission,
yeah.
And they continue to increase, especially transmission. We know what capacity will do in the next 3 years,
yeah.
But transmission will continue to increase. So these opportunities are very important.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
And there's more to your report, right?
Yes.
Yeah, the exciting part.
Oh, right. That was the dull part.
So we'll wake the rest of the commission up. So This is the last. This is just the summary of the resources that dispatch each month. And you'll note that the little yellow bar in July is pretty much gone. We got an awful lot of load coverage from NextEra under the load following approach. So basically, we shifted out of the market and into the NextEra coverage on that. But you can see where the budgeted kilowatt hours came up. And if you look, May and June were both below budgeted amounts. They were relatively mild temperature-wise, so we didn't incur air conditioning load in those. When we got to July, though, which, if you remember, was a little on the warm side, you can see that we're actually above the budgeted threshold. But the NextEra load following agreement stepped in and covered that. Things on power supply right now are going well. So I thought, hey, let's do something a little bit different. See if we can excite this and energize it. So what we did was we've put together a couple of slides that say, here's where we are now. How did we get there? And then we're going to take a look at where we're going and sort of what opportunities we have and how we're going to be shaping power supply going forward. What we did was we broke our portfolio into carbon and non-carbon resources so that we can tell each year what portion of our portfolio is non-carbon generation. And if you take a look, we dated this all the way back to 2010 when we were just under 20%. Through 2019, this is just the first half, when we're up around 37%. In 2018, we clipped over 30%. So we've grown the green component of our portfolio rather dramatically. And to put this in perspective, we're currently discussing with the state how municipal light plants ought to match the renewable portfolio standard and the clean energy standard goals that have been established for the investor-owned utilities. So I apologize I didn't have these as slides in the packet. We can make the information distributed. But just for this past year, 2018, for example, the renewable portfolio standard was, I believe, about 13% of the portfolio was to be renewable energy under the state's definition. The clean energy standard was 16%. RMLD's portfolio was 31%. So we've got a pretty nice margin to work with there. The renewable portfolio standard goes up to 2019 by 1%, so it's about 15%. The clean energy standard goes up by 2%, so that's 18%. We are currently sitting on 37% of our portfolio is green for the first half of 2019.
Non-carbon.
Non-carbon.
Do we have questions on that?
No. I know you have a question about it, though.
Yeah.
What makes you think that?
I don't know. You had that look in your eye.
You said under the state's definition, we have these numbers.
There's a statutory definition for the renewable portfolio standard, what qualifies as a renewable resource with the acquisition of RECs. We do not keep the RECs in our portfolio.
So that's where we need to, I think we need to explain both of those things. We need the numbers as you're presenting them and the definitions that we're using or that the community's using, and then what the state definitions are. I think we kind of owe that to the public.
The renewable portfolio standard requires that the entity claiming renewable resources in their mix, is acquiring the RECs, the renewable energy certificates, that certain qualifying renewable plants create under Class 1 or Class 2 definitions. We do not retire RECs. We buy the energy output for 10 to 20 years from these plants, and the RECs are sold to somebody else. We do not take credit for meeting the renewable portfolio standard. On the other hand, the clean energy standard does not require the acquisition and retirement of RECs. That is non-carbon generation. Under that, we can legitimately compare what our portfolio is doing to what the state standard this year is. The clean energy standard was established.
I'm sorry, go ahead. Finish that sentence.
The clean energy standard was established at 16% of the utilities portfolio in 2018. It grows by 2% a year until it reaches 80% in 2050.
Whose standard is the clean energy standard?
That's a state standard.
The state has something called a clean energy standard.
Yes.
Okay. I find all of this very confusing.
It's intended to be.
Yeah. Well.
That's why you hired me.
Yeah. I did. Well, that's why we begged Colleen to hire you. Yeah, we didn't do it. We begged Colleen.
If I am confusing the commission, I am doing my job.
Well. But, yeah, there are these different ways these things are looked at, and depending on
you. Can I just...
Please.
Let me chime in just for a second, because I think this will help. And I've talked to Zach about this. It wasn't ready for tonight, but we're putting together pretty much a timeline that looks at what all of our available blocks are and what blocks of energy we've already purchased. And then superimposing over what's considered clean energy standards, what is the RPS standard? What is the golden bill that as municipals is our bottom floor? And all of those things will be highlighted in for not only a presentation to you, but also so that we, as projects come up in the future, we can see how we can layer those things in to meet certain milestones. Now, I know we've clarified sustainable with renewable and all those type of things, and we haven't got to a point where you've made a vote or I've made a recommendation, because we as the municipals have asked to set at least a bottom bar on that. Now, the commissioners can vote for whatever. Municipals are at this time exempt from RPS, but we all came forward and said instead of being exempt, we would like to present to you, because we are not regulated, you know, a lot of the nuclear and carbon-free plants that the customers here have already invested in, and to be able to take credit for those as clean energy. So you'll see the entire layout and everything highlighted so that you can look at it and figure the whole thing out, answer all your questions, Dave. We just didn't have that ready for this evening, but it will be presented within the next month.
So it'll be the every way of looking at this, including the way that
every way, correct.
Including the way that somebody would be the most
correct.
Uncharitable way of looking at it will also be part of that.
Well, I think it will help the commission take a look and determine for that policy of how they want to go forward, whether you want to be above the golden bill, whether you want to meet the RPS, and we'll also try to present a couple of things. What is the cost of renewable clean going forward? And also, let's keep in mind that while we would all like to clean everything, there's only a limited amount of plants that are actually built or that are going to be built. So we already have four projects that we're working on and trying to be part of. They haven't been built yet, and they need people to commit to those contracts up front. But those would go into the portfolio. But again, it's not like there's a lot of things built that we can just say, well, there's endless renewable. Let's just change how we do business and sign up, because they're not there. So we have to work with, you know, investing in them as well in this general area.
Yep.
Does that make sense? Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
So we're going to do that presentation for you.
Think of the tool being for you a current position. position that's forward-looking, and then for us, a tool to analyze future opportunities as we stack potential resources within that.
That sounds great.
I think it's what you're looking for. I need it as a tool, they need it as a tool, and it helps. It'll help everyone, but it is something that Zach's going to help build. So
that's great.
Well, can you put up the this slide shows essentially where we are, what we have for commitments going forward. In 3 years' time, 70% of our portfolio is open to the market. So we have a lot of decisions to make about short-term versus long-term, how we want to engage and at what rate some of these opportunities that are out there. There are cost trade-offs to decisions that we make. There are environmental considerations and trade-offs. So we basically have an awful lot of opportunity staring us in the face. Big pieces of it actually coming up in 18 months, which in power supply planning is an unbelievably short horizon. It's like 11:59 on the clock to midnight. Now, what I will point out, we don't have the line on this particular chart, but we're looking at 98% of our portfolio being green when our bilateral agreements expire. And we are in compliance with, we meet the target thresholds for the clean energy standard, which is the more aggressive, through 2026. So we've got a 6-year horizon in which we're already under committed obligations that will meet that standard. So I think we're in pretty good shape right now. We've got some decisions to make about the opportunities in front of us. But what I wanted to do tonight was just kind of set the stage and say, here's where we are, and here's what we can do. We are pretty wide open. And what we do have for commitments is essentially green.
Can I ask a question? So, Chuck, with 18 months or so, you have a lot of decisions to make, or before that, probably.
We have some decisions to make. We have resources that we are aware of that are longer-term commitments, unit purchases in green technologies. I don't have to label them beyond that because the RECs will come with them and we can decide, you know, what we want to do. That's going to depend on how the legislation sugars off and, you know, what our obligations are. But
the maple syrup analogy you just used, sugars off?
Yes.
He's from Vermont.
Well, I was a little confused because the sugaring season doesn't start for 6 months. And I don't want to use up the first third of my 18-month window. You know, we can enter into short-term bilateral agreements to cover our exposure. Those would be predominantly natural gas contracts.
I see.
We can make some purchases in nuclear, which is a dispatchable non-carbon resource. We can buy into wind and other green resources.
So you're hedging as you go. Because I was just wondering if there was a big event, world event, that affected energy prices, we could really be exposed, right, if you have a lot of buying decisions to make between now and then.
Could be.
Yeah.
But we made some purchases about 2 weeks ago under our TFA. We bought about $9 million worth of kilowatt hours going out 4 years?
2023.
So, yeah, 3.5 years.
Yeah.
So we take opportunities as they present themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But just wanted to sort of share with the commission that we're wide open.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's good.
Thanks.
Good
stuff.
And in a good position.
Great. Thank you.
I think that was the last one, wasn't it?
This is the capacity.
Oh, this just goes back to the earlier discussion when we were talking about what we know.
Yep.
Capacity costs are falling. Therefore, the incentive that we can offer to customers to reduce financial impacts on our MLD is diminishing.
If you don't mind, I want to have some comments here. So you know 3 years out in advance what capacity prices look like. And that market, out of the whole power supply portfolio costs, like Chuck was saying, 10 to 15%, the rest is in energy. But this market's extremely volatile. And if we look back from 2010 to 2013, it was steadily, you know, declining or remaining flat. But if we go to the next slide, you know, it carried on a little bit, carried on. Next slide, huge jump. And this is where, you know, market risks come in to play. There's not enough resources online, so we have to increase the capacity price to bring more incentive for resources to come. As the resources come online, next
slide.
Decline. We're in this time period now where it's flat, and that revenue.
You know it's going to be that way for another 4 years.
Yep. So you see 2022, 2023.
Yeah. There's an auction that goes out 3 years ahead. So in February, we will know what the 2024 capacity price is going to be.
So that's a good risk indicator for where the energy market is. So that's a very helpful tool that we can use.
Great.
This is also what we have to plan against. And how do you make a 20 to 30 year long-term power supply decision when your capacity market is doing that, when you don't know what the volatility of the energy market is going to be?
If it really spikes, you know, that can get up into 20 to 25% of your whole portfolio costs.
Wow. Helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Very, very good.
Thanks, Chuck and Zach.
Yeah.
Wait, I have one more question for you. I'm sorry to do this to you. There had been some discussion at that solar workshop about our rates, about our solar rates, and you've mentioned that you're working on a redesign of the solar rates that we give people.
Yes.
Is there any update on that or where you see that going?
We have a draft. Zach's first challenge opportunity when he arrived was to look at the rate, determine what an equivalent in-and-out rate for the wholesale on solar would be, and to come up with a facilities charge. Colleen has tasked me with doing a cost-of-service study, including an allocation and revisiting of the rates, and it doesn't make sense to launch that and then a short time later, you know, launch other changes. So that will be put into the rate package for global discussion.
Which is in the spring, is it? What is that?
Yeah.
In the spring?
It should be over the winter for effect January 1st.
Okay. Well, so typically we get the rates and we vote on them in a, I mean, could we get some advance? Maybe, yeah.
When that may have been the last time, but that's not under me. You'll get them, you'll vote on them and we'll implement them the next day.
Okay, well, I mean just having drafts to look at before.
Yes.
Yeah, we've been doing the rate, not the cost of service. That could affect for an additional discussion after he's done with the cost of service. But any rate adjustments, because remember with residents, we were bringing them back to a 0%. We had some phasing in for the last rate discussion that we had. So that will be presented at the budget, similar in line up with the financials, the same as what we did last year.
Okay.
But are you talking specifically about the solar garden and other concepts that they're designing?
Well, yeah, because it's different, and it's something that has been talked about in the community, and it's something a lot of people are interested in. So
the solar garden would be outside of the rate package.
Okay. Well, I meant solar in general.
Residential solar.
Yes.
And equitable rate for the solar customer.
Yes. That's kind of what I was thinking. I wasn't thinking solar garden. I was thinking about the residential customer.
Yes.
What changes, if any, do you foresee proposed? proposing in that?
Structurally, what we're looking at is going to a facilities charge based on the size of the system, which recovers our costs in keeping the customer connected and managing the in and out transactions. If you remember from the solar workshop, only about 35% of the energy that a customer produces is used directly by the customer.
Right.
The other 65% is either pushed out onto the grid and then banked for the customer's usage, or is provided at times when the solar system isn't working, nighttime, snowfall, whatever. So we would charge a facilities charge for that essentially connected solar load. And then we would have an in and out transaction price that represents the offset that solar makes to the wholesale market. So it doesn't have the same financial pricing that a typical residential customer load shape would have. Solar operates on a much narrower window than customers consume. And so we look at the pricing within that production window.
As I understood it, some of the complaints we heard at that meeting were that we net meter like in an instantaneous basis rather than around, you know, kind of a monthly reconciliation, and that was what we heard a couple of people saying that we were doing that was maybe should be looked at. Did I get that right?
You did, and because we would be going to this different structure, that problem will go away.
Okay.
It'll bring it to a more equitable rate.
Okay. Thanks, Chuck.
Okay. Any other?
Thank you, Chuck.
I guess we're, Wendy? Actually, I have another question for Chuck. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding.
You're on the water, Dave.
This is a good joke there with that line, but we'll leave that alone.
It's been 2 months since we had a meeting, I think.
What time is it?
You've been saving it up, Dave. 45 minutes into this. What?
You've been saving it up for
I mean, it's. I think we'll still be out of here in an hour and 20 minutes. But.
Not after you read your six motions.
Well, that's true. I think Phil will do that.
Do we want to start with the... do we want to do the financial report first, or do we want to do the motions first?
We'll do the motions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Phil, you're up.
So let me ask a question. Can we vote? Can we move all these at one time?
Let's see.
Any legal requirement that we got to do each separate one?
You're talking about voting on them?
Well, what I would do, I would say move the seven, there are seven of them here from what I can count. Move the seven motions as presented in the agenda and make the agendas part of the minutes.
Well, didn't you just, I mean, it seems like a legal question, right? So.
Well, I think, make sure I understand it. So if you do that, that presumes, I guess, that nobody has any questions on it.
Well, yeah, that's right. Yeah, I'm assuming that, too. Yeah,
let's just go through them one by one, just to be err on the side of caution, because somebody said it's
maybe we can take discussion after all of them are read.
How about that?
Let me ask this. I've read these. I have no issues with any of the seven.
Okay.
Is there any objection to anybody having at this point?
Why don't we take what Wendy just said? Why don't we have an overall discussion about what all of these are about?
Right.
And what each one is about, so we hear all of that at once, and then maybe we can tick through them. Does that sound like a good compromise?
Yeah, I like that.
Wendy.
Discussion now?
Please.
Okay, sure. So basically we got a request from the town of Reading asking us if we would ask the commission to vote to reaccept Chapter 32B, Section 20, which basically is, it's an OPEB statute, and basically what the statute will do will give us more provisions to follow GASB the proper way, especially since the GASB rules have been changing. So this will keep us closer in the lines of GASB, and it also will allow us now to invest in the Pension Reserve Investment Trust,
or the State Retirement Benefits Trust. And what that will help us with is to meet our actuarial study of yielding 7.5% interest on the funds. So there's really no big change. The statute is back in 2011. The commission voted on it, and now they're asking to revote for the simple sake of investing the funds with the retirement trust fund.
Can I just ask where? Go ahead, Dave.
How did this start? Our decision to put these.
The town of Reading.
Came to you.
Yes, Sharon Engstrom sent me an email to ask if I asked the commission to vote on this to accept it, since they have the funds, and we, the RMLD, has taken the approach in the past to let the treasurer be the custodian of the funds. And we have given them full power to invest in whichever way they invest. So she's asking us now if we want to continue to do it that way. And with this, with accepting, reaccepting this statute, we will be allowed to vote in better trust fund. I mean, not vote, I'm sorry, invest in better trust funds.
And just to be clear to anybody watching, both of you, that there's a bunch of motions here dealing with this issue, and we've just asked Wendy to explain overall what these motions as a group are about, so that
yes,
when we go into them, we'll have a kind of a general roundup of what it is, what the topic is at hand.
So we are asking that we continue with the idea that the treasurer of the town be the custodian of the funds.
Yep.
Since he does have control of all the funds, he watches them closely, he invests, he asks us, you know, if we're comfortable with certain things. And that's basically what we're asking.
The only thing I'm wondering about is this 7.5% goal of annual returns. Like, who's guaranteeing that these days? And
well, right now we're yielding a little over 2%.
Yep.
And if we invest in the state retirement
yep.
trust fund, it's right now that's the average, about 7.5%.
What are they putting that in? Which slot machine is that going in?
Yeah, it seems like there'd probably be more risk. Right?
I'd say. But, I mean, sure, since 2009, it's pretty easy to get 7.5%. But
let's remember when we have the audit presentation
yep.
and we continue to present these actuarial reports,
yep.
we're not meeting the investment.
Correct. That's where this came up, right? It was at the... When we were conservatively positioned,
right.
So we were positioned for being from 2011. Okay, but we were well situated from if that had been from the period of 2002 to 2009, so we would have looked brilliant, right? Because otherwise we'd have lost half of our money in 2008 and 2009.
Yeah,
this is just for
but other people look great because they were situated in a different way. 2009 through now, and now we're saying let's go back in.
Right.
I know it seems like it's late in the game.
I mean, I'm not so sure our conservative, you know, philosophy is over the great long view is really always bad. But
well, we also have the ability.
Yep.
If we do this, we also have the ability to watch where it goes, and we can recommend that we either take the funds out or,
yep.
You know, so that is what we are going to propose when we actually. Vote
yep.
to accept the trust.
So may I take the point that when people see a 2% return and they're wondering why is it only 2%, it's a good question to ask, and I take it that everybody's working hard to do the best with our pension funds.
Well, but these are, you know, it's all Massachusetts
yep.
funds. So this is the other post-employment benefits. So this is the health insurance, basically.
Yep. Okay. Do you want to go through the motions one by one?
Well, no, I think we could move all seven of them at one time. I
have one more question, though. So, Wendy, you're saying that we don't have to mirror the investment portfolio of the town's OPEB. We can have it different.
We can request the trustee, which is the treasurer, the custodian, we can request to provide us with different investment opportunities.
Okay. So we can make it more conservative. But it's just a request. We can't mandate it.
Okay. So why don't we?
I have the same concern you do, Dave. I mean, the stock market's been running up for 10 years, and now it sounds like we're going to get more aggressive.
Right.
And maybe it's time for a checkup in the stock market, and we could reset.
Yeah, please.
The money's been being invested by the town, has it not?
It's already been.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
And
right.
They're going to continue to invest it.
That's
they
right.
would like to invest it in this particular retirement. Trust
requires that we come, you know, re-certify.
Re-accept.
Yeah.
But we still have, the way we wrote it, is we still, you still have the ability to tell the custodian, meaning the town treasurer, we don't like that, we want it over here.
Okay.
But they've been investing it all along, so I see what you're saying. Do you not want to leave the conservative approach and go to the...
I don't know, I just think...
I think
the timing, I'm just nervous about the timing of it. The stock market's had one of the greatest run-ups it's had ever over the last 10 years. And then if we start getting aggressive with our portfolio now, it seems like it's bad timing, that's all. I just would want us to wade in to the market more aggressively. Like today, you have the same concern. So.
Oh, just a gut feeling, Tom.
Yeah, so I don't remember myself, but it seems to me that when we had the audit committee, we went through this, and I thought that the auditor, the external auditor, who do we use?
Lanson Heath.
I thought, I know I raised the issue, I thought we discussed that, and I vaguely remember them agreeing with the move, and I had the same concern, and I said, you know, 7.5 seems fairly aggressive, and but I don't, honestly, I can't remember the final outcome, and it would seem to me that since we pay them, that they must have made an opinion, but Phil, do you remember?
I don't remember off the top of my head. I have to go back and refresh my memory.
I mean, we keep talking about, you know, this idea of when we're going to be fully funded,
yeah,
and it's based on this 7.5%.
Right.
So we're nowhere near that when we're only yielding 2%. We're nowhere near that. So it's a bigger liability to the RMLD when you don't invest your funds more aggressively.
Right. It's like Colleen says. I mean, the town's already doing investing right now. I mean, you know, God forbid, I'm not a financial investment expert for any stretch of the imagination. I mean, I'm hoping that the town actually has professionals that they're, you know, if I invest in a mutual fund, I'm not going to tell the mutual fund people how to invest. I expect them to do the best, you know, in what they're doing.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me this, I guess what you're hearing from some of the board members is that, you know, if it's 2009 or 2008, 2009, you're right in terms of, you know, if we don't do anything, we'll, you know, it's like inflation. But on the other hand, if we lose half the pie, we're really going to be, you know.
Right, because we might be sitting here in this economic cycle. It might be 2007 right now, like in the way the stock market's run up. I'm just concerned that if we make a big move, I think it's the right thing to do. I'd just be afraid that we did it all at once. All of a sudden, it's much greater exposure to the stock market all of a sudden. If we waited in over some time, I'd like that approach. So, that's all. I still think we should do it. I just think, you know, I'd want that advice to be out there.
Okay. Are we ready to read these motions then?
Go. Do you want to do them all at once, or what do we want to do?
Well, Phil, I think just as a point of order, I would think for those who aren't physically sitting here, I'm not an expert on process in this area, but it would seem to me that if we don't read them, who's ever participating has no idea.
Yeah, let's read each one.
Okay. All right.
I'll alternate with you. You can read one. I'll read one.
I don't have. I'm losing. I'll fold the 10 grand. Agree to read them.
Thank you, Phil.
Okay.
All right.
Move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that the Reading Municipal Light Department hereby accepts the provisions of Chapter 32B, Section 20. Of the Mass General Laws as amended by Chapter 218, Section 15 of the Acts of 2016, Parents, the Act, in quotes, the word Act in quotes, which shall govern its other post-employment benefits liability trust fund, Parents, the OPEB fund being in quotes, and its parents.
Okay. Second?
Second.
Okay, so.
The only thing I want to add, this is on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Correct.
All these should have the recommendation of general manager at the end.
Okay, and just to be proper, Wendy, why don't you just tell us what this particular one, I know we just had a discussion, but just so that we're following proper steps here.
Yeah, we have already accepted, the RMLD has already accepted Chapter 32B, Section 20.
Yep.
All you're doing in this motion is re-accepting the provisions of Chapter 32B, Section 20.
Okay.
As amended by Chapter 218. That's all you're doing. It's pretty much the same,
yep.
Except Now, like I said, we're following closer to the GASB standards.
Yep.
And you get to invest in the state retirement board benefits.
Okay. Any other questions on that? All in favor? And it's a 4-0 vote, right, with John absent. Next up.
Okay, move that the... move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that, in accordance with the Act, the Reading Municipal Light Department hereby designates the treasurer of the Town of Reading to serve as the custodian of the OPEB fund, parentheses, the custodian in quotes, and parentheses.
Okay.
Recommendation of the general manager?
On the recommendation.
On the recommendation of the general manager.
Right.
Wait a second.
Second.
Okay.
This is basically just saying that the RMLD is accepting that, I mean, is requesting that the town treasurer be the custodian because he or whoever may be in that seat looks closely at the funds.
Okay.
Procedural question here, Mr. Chair. Now that we're doing them separately, you have a reference here to say with the Act. How do we know what Act that that refers to?
It refers to it right up there, the Act.
But that's a separate motion.
But right, so that Phil's
so we've already defined it.
Phil is now proving that he was right all along. And the point is...
Just a point of order.
Yes.
So, but if you don't read the motion, then not only if you don't know what Act it is, you know what the motion is.
Right. So I think, do you need to restate the motion with the...
Can I interject?
Yes, please.
The reason that the motions are different is because you do have other options. But these are the options we've been advised to take, and these are the options that Colleen and myself have discussed makes the most sense for this particular.
Right, but Phil's making a kind of a semantic point that it just says the Act, and it's the Act is only defined in the previous motion. That's his point, and it's a good one. So
can I just read it again and say that the Act as defined in the previous motion?
Why don't we make a motion to say that reference to these seven motions, and we define the word Act as a separate motion.
Yeah, I think here I need to reverse my earlier after consideration. Phil is the sort of the master of the Senate in this in this context. So, Phil, you've been doing this a while. You have the procedural stuff down. How is the best way to read all these?
So I think the best way to do it, in my recommendation, is that we table the motion for just now.
Yep.
We create another motion that says, the Board of Commissioners, let me think the proper wording here now. Board of Commissioners move that the seven motions related to the Act is referring to the provisions of Chapter 32B,
yep.
Section 20 of the Mass General Laws is amended by Chapter 218, Section 15 of the Acts of 2016. We move that the definition of the word Act, the Act, for these seven motions be, and the reference.
Yeah.
So we have it all one.
I think, though, they all don't refer to the Act.
Yeah, just the first two, it looks like.
Just the first two.
Yeah. So why don't you just reread the second motion with the full Act language in it, and we'll just keep going.
All right. So why don't I'll move then, because I'll move to amend.
Yep.
The motion, move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that accords with the provisions of Chapter 32B, Section 20 of the Massachusetts General Laws, as amended by Chapter 218,
yep.
Section 15 of the Acts of the 2016,
yep.
The RMLD, the Reading Municipal Light Board, I'll try again, Department hereby designates the treasurer of the Town of Reading to serve as the custodian of the other post-employment benefits liability trust fund.
Okay.
So you need to spell out instead of using the words OPEB.
So now we've amended the earlier motion.
Right.
And so now we just need a second. Right?
Okay. Second.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think we've talked about this quite a bit.
Yep.
But I think we're ready for a vote.
Yep.
As amended, all in favor? Okay. If that's four and all opposed is none. So it's 4-0 with John.
We need to take one more motion, the final motion. Because you just voted on the amendment. Now you need to take a vote on the final.
Okay, thank you. Now we vote on the original motion. Is that right?
As amended.
As amended, we vote on the original motion that Dave made. In Do we have a second already?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so all in favor of that is 4-0.
All right.
Okay, good. Glad we got through that.
That was simple.
Yeah, it was. Let the lawyers read those minutes.
Move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that the Declaration of Trust presented by the General Manager be adopted by the Reading Municipal Light Department and executed by the Board of Commissioners on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Questions?
I do have another comment.
Oh, go ahead.
Okay. So this is just that you're reaccepting the Chapter 32B, Section 20. There is going to be a follow-up. We're going to develop an actual trust. Okay, so that is to follow, just so you know. It's coming up.
Okay.
Say something. The trust document will then go into specificity on what you can do, direct the,
yes.
You know what I mean? So it's kind of a two-part process. We'll turn the money over and he'll start to invest. But very quickly we'll come up with, we don't want to hold up the town from investing.
Yep.
So we'll develop the trust and the specifics of the trust, and then you can go on.
Are there post-employment benefits liability trust fund?
Yes. Yes.
All right. That we have a motion and a second and discussion. So
yep.
Ready to vote.
All those in favor?
All in favor?
Yep.
4. All opposed? 0.
Okay.
Okay. The motion passes.
Okay.
Dave?
Move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that the Reading Municipal Light Department transfer any and all monies currently held for the purpose of paying retiree health and life benefits. To such, now Phil told me how to read this, other post-employment benefits liability trust fund on the recommendation of the general manager.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. I just have a question. So is this to such OPEB fund? Is that what is
English?
Is it
English?
No, where? It's not referenced
it's
in the motion. To such.
What do you mean?
He's wondering if it makes sense.
Well, usually you talk about the OPEB fund, and then you would then refer to it as such OPEB fund. So, if it's clear to everybody else, I guess I'm okay.
No, I know what you're saying. These motions are not.
But can I?
What I'm saying is, it's the word OPEB fund isn't mentioned in the motion, or even in the motion above it. So it's.
I understand, but I think what it means is whatever the RMLD decides to invest in, that becomes the new fund. So all the money that's sitting in the current fund will just be transferred to that fund. I believe that is what this is referring to.
Each other.
And he told
yeah.
me to have you vote on them separately. So
who's this lawyer? Because, I mean, you know, now that we're really looking at this, and Tom's point is right. When you have a motion and there's this sentence and it says to such OPEB fund, it doesn't make any sense.
The OPEB fund is in the first motion, with the description of it.
They're all connected, it seems.
Phil's original.
We should have done
exactly.
What Phil said.
You're right, Dennis. I mean, it's like.
So why don't we just take the word such out and replace it with the word the?
Okay.
Like the next motion. It says the OPEB fund.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, let's replace
let's
that word
that.
The.
And so do we need to.
We can vote.
Accept the motion.
I mean, there's only one.
Second as.
Well, if the maker of the motion will accept that as part of the main motion,
yes.
We don't have to vote an amendment.
Fine, then.
No. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
We'll be done by, 10 p.m. at least? Okay.
What do you think, Dennis? How's that pacing?
We have a
Patriots sat
motion
outside.
In a second. We have a motion in a second, right?
Here we go.
Mm-hmm. All in favor? As amended. Okay, 4-0.
Okay.
You're up.
I got the next one. Move the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that the custodian of the other post-employment benefit fund be designated as trustee of the other post-employment benefit fund
on the recommendations of the manager.
Second.
Okay. I think we're good, right?
Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. We have a motion and a second. I think we're ready to vote, okay?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Yes.
Four. All opposed?
Okay.
Zero.
Okay. Move that.
You got the word such there, so you need to make sure you say that as the.
Okay, the. Okay. Okay. Move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that the Reading Municipal Light Department authorize and direct the trustee to invest and reinvest the monies in the other post-employment benefits liability trust fund and the state retiree benefits trust fund.
On the recommendation,
General Manager. On the recommendation of the General Manager.
Okay.
Okay. Second?
Second.
Okay. All right. All in favor?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 4-0, the motion passes, and I think we've now got this done.
We got one more.
Oh, good.
Last one. Move that the Board of Commissioners approve the resolution that the Treasurer of the Town of Reading, as custodian of the other post-employment benefit funds liability trust fund, be and hereby is authorized to execute and deliver the investment agreement with the State Retirees Benefits Trust Fund Board of Trustees on behalf of the Reading Municipal Light Department for the purpose of making the representation and warranties, acknowledgments, and agreements on the part of the Reading Municipal Light Department to be made and performed thereunder on the recommendation of the manager.
Okay. We talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Tom?
So
do we have a second?
Second.
The investment agreement, maybe that's more discussion than needed. So that, is that something that's already been discussed and approved, and does that really call out where we want the monies to be invested on our behalf?
You're talking about the previous motion?
No, the one we're in now.
Oh, this one.
Yes, yeah, so the investment agreement, because I think what it's saying is we're giving the custodian, the treasurer of the town of Reading, authorization to invest in basically in accordance with the investment agreement. And if that's the case, I assume we've already agreed on the investment agreement, so the essence of the motion really is about giving the custodian the ability to implement, right?
Well, we were making this decision based on the audit presentation and the actuarial reports that we thought that everyone was in agreement that we should invest in a more aggressive fund. So I believe that we were on the lines of thinking that it was going to
be
invested.
Is there an actually, I guess what I was thinking, is there an actual investment agreement that says we will invest, here's how we will invest the portfolio? Or is it just a loosely, you know, we agreed to do something? I guess that's what I'm asking.
I don't have anything, I don't have any document from the town at this time.
Yeah.
I can request one.
I'm not quite sure what we're asking to be done. I mean, to Colleen's point, I think the real issue to Colleen's point, we've always invested very conservatively. It appears that there's been a discussion on putting all of us around being more less risk averse, shall we say. So, I know, Phil, you sit on the investment committees. I mean, I'm not from a the progress of here, but I just
what invest your opinion am I sitting on?
I mean, the audit committee.
The audit committee, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, well, that's which is very different. Investment.
I hope so. I'm like, oh.
I guess I just, for me, clarity is what are we approving exactly?
I was under the impression that the investment agreement was the agreement with the PRID.
Right, but we don't have any document yet.
Okay, that's the trust, right? That's going to give some specificity to it. I didn't know that was being called the agreement.
I don't think the trust is the actual, I'm not positive. I mean, we would have to ask Chris. As far as what the definition of this language is versus the trust that we're creating. I thought the motion right now is basically just saying that we're going to invest in PRIT.
That was my understanding, and the agreement was between the treasurer and the PRIT that we're telling them to do that.
So we're basically, the town of Reading has asked us to do all of these things, and in our wisdom, we want to do them, and we want to all be on the same page, and we believe that we're all, I I think everybody's working in good faith here.
Yes.
And some of this is, frankly, there's a bit of mumbo jumbo to some of us here, and some, you know, some English issues in some of these wording of this language that we got from the lawyer. But I think we all have a high level understanding that we've had a request from the town to do this, and we're doing it.
Right.
Yes.
That's the bottom line. And with once we do this last vote, we will have gotten through it.
Yep.
Correct?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Just to be kind of summarize it in a sentence.
Mm-hmm.
And did we have a motion in a second? We did, right?
Second, yeah.
Yep.
Okay. And are we ready to vote on this last motion? Okay. Let's do it. All in favor? Okay. 4. All opposed? 0. John, mercifully for him, who was absent tonight. So, hope you all enjoyed that. Both asleep.
Message was to read the agenda carefully before you show.
Yeah, that's what I tried to have you do before the meeting, Tom. You know, it's true. I mean, it's on me as chairman to carefully read these, and I should have noticed these kind of English issues, and I didn't. So that's on me.
Okay.
So
we forgive you.
Well, thank
you're forgiven.
You.
You're forgiven.
Yeah, I didn't carefully read each one of these sub motions. So I'll do that next time. But we rely on our legal counsel to give us complete sentences.
Well, I mean, in deference, I mean, it's a complicated thing. Will you do them all at once? Right? We have this happen. How often do we do this? Once every millennium or something? But the other part, the reality is, you don't really know what questions you have till the motion's read and explained. So,
thank you, Tom. Okay.
Thankfully,
we got through it.
We did.
We got through it, though.
Okay.
Would you like a brief financial report or no?
Yes.
Yes, I would.
The key word was brief.
Yes, it's very brief. Okay. I am presenting. I have presented the financials in your packet for year-to-date July 31st, and I can tell you that $7 million of operating expenses is about 2.8 times the unrestricted cash amount of $19.5 million. I can proudly tell you that our receivables are at 99% current. That's a big deal. So we're really excited about that. Currently, the overall operating, maintenance, and general administrative expenses are 15% under budget, but we still have 4 months to go, and we have a lot of work to do. So I can just give you a brief presentation here. Based on our last meeting, I had some comments and some requests. So if you're looking at the capital spending versus the depreciation reserve, I would like to remind you that 3% of our depreciable gross plant is for depreciation, and that is what is reserved for capital funds, for capital spending. And this chart right here shows you that with the exception of FY15, the depreciation reserve is much less than the capital improvements the RMLD has made and will make going forward. I just wanted to show you where the funds are coming from there. So the next one, I believe, Tom, you asked me to show something on the kilowatt hours sold. So we did a little comparison here, 5-year comparison, and basically what it's showing is the trend. And it's very the trend is very consistent if you look at that. Each group of colors is 1 year. So from 2015 through August of 2019, you see that up and down with the weather months. We were talking about the cooling and the heating that Chuck and Colleen spoke about last time, and the trend is pretty consistent. So I just wanted to show that. And the next chart, it shows you by month the comparison from 2017 through August of 2019. It shows you by month pretty much where we are in each month, and a lot of that has to do with weather. That concludes my presentation.
All right. Thank you, Wendy.
Thanks, Wendy.
Wendy, I can't remember. Those are good charts. Could we get a copy of those, or are they in the? Were they in the?
They were not, but I'll be happy to send them to you.
Okay. Yeah, don't rush on it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All of Chuck's charts were in here, by the way.
Okay.
I think the only thing that we missed were Wendy's.
Chuck's charts.
Chuck, your charts were in here. Even the, I thought you said they were in
there. Oh, sure. Sure. We'll wait here.
Maybe we can't read any more. Sorry.
I'm going to keep it.
Oh, can we start or no? We have to wait for it.
We still have a quorum. Let's carry on.
Yeah. Okay, great. Well, I'm going to make it short and sweet, so I know it's late and probably the people are going to go home. I got a few slides. This is the project, what you see, Grove Street and Franklin Street that, you know,
yep.
we showed you how,
yep.
you know, it was a safety concern, which we worked, we collaborated and cooperated with the town and the residents, and, you know, we finally made it safe. So this shows the project completed, done, and now I can have a good night's sleep, I hope so. So the next one shows the major construction projects that basically all the projects are going well, as expected. We are right on the target, and by the year end, they're all going to be completed, and we're going to be where we need to be. So basically, those are all the locations of those smart grid switches. This one, this particular one, the picture you see, that's on Industrial Ave, which the construction just recently completed. The next slide is showing you for the getaway 4W6, 4W16. These are the getaway replacements out of the station 4 for increasing the ampacity, the feeders coming out of the station. And we've done some area upgrades. We've done a lot of them this year. Same as last year, but the pictures that you see, these are the area upgrades on Deborah Drive in Reading, which the crews, they replaced poles and upgraded the primary wires, secondaries, connections, transformer upgrades, and everything, which this was one of the oldest sections that we needed to take care of for reliability reasons. The next slide is showing also a Todd Lane and Cranberry Lane in Linfield that we replaced two Padmont transformers. That's where those pictures are coming from, Todd Lane in Linfield. These are again part of those upgrades on the transformers, the aged transformers that, you know, we've been taking care of. And pretty much we've replaced lots and lots of transformers this year as part of that campaign in order to even further improve the reliability. So the next one shows the maintenance programs that, you know, we are on target again across all the areas. I don't see any problem, nothing that concerns me. The infrared scan of the substations and all the parks, everything is good as we expected because the maintenance is on target. The next slide is showing the basically the status of the poles in engines. You see the poles, number of poles. We got 72 transfers to do in Linfield and Reading, 35 transfers. So the good news is that, you know, well, Verizon has completed installing poles for the projects that, you know, we need to complete, and we cannot get the pole transfers started. We have to wait for Verizon to set all the poles, and that's why the numbers in these two towns, because we've got a huge project that it's underway, it's going, it's in progress. And they're all going to be completed by end of the year. Actually, one is going to be completed in November, the other one is going to be completed by December. And once they're completed, then we are done, and you're going to see these numbers are going down pretty much. The other two towns, that Reading and Wilmington, there's not much. We got North Reading, we got one transfer, and Wilmington, we got like two transfers. So we are on target on those two. The next one shows the reliability indices. Again, good news. We're all, you know, we're doing very well as expected with the maintenance program. So we're all across the board with those indices. SAIDI, KDI, and SAIFI, well below the national and regional averages. So we've got one of the strongest reliabilities in the Northeast. So the next slide shows you the causes of the outages. As you could see, that it shows our maintenance program is working. The number of equipment compared year to date for average, we are well below almost half of what you used to. That means it's working. The trees are below, and also the wildlife. But unfortunately, motor vehicle accidents, they've been going up, and I have no control over that. And the weather, also the weather been up. If had lots of storms, and so most of the outages are related to those. And pretty much that's it. That concludes my meeting, unless if you have questions.
Questions for me?
No.
No, thank you, Amit.
You're welcome. So I got some bids.
Okay.
Let you know if you could, go over those.
You wrote these in language of these bids, right?
Who writes it? Who writes it?
Whoever you want. The actual text of the language. Was it you? Or was it a lawyer?
This is basically pretty much the template that we have of our materials management group.
Okay.
They're doing a really awesome
this
job.
This is written internally.
Yeah.
And I noticed that they are in English.
Yes. And these are short sentences, so at least you can comprehend them.
Okay, thank you.
But yeah, I just got one question.
Sure.
You've got 104, 400, period, and then you've got two zeros and a one?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Are we a tenth of a cent?
Yeah, that's the,
all right.
That's 104,000.
Yeah, I will. Move that IFB 2019-13. For mailing services for municipal electric bills be awarded to Data Integrators Incorporated, option B, for $104,400 pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 30B as the lowest responsive and responsive bidder on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Second. Any discussion? Okay. Okay, vote. All in favor? 4-0.
Do you need any explanation, or we're all
well,
set?
I mean,
this is pretty much pretty obvious.
It's pretty self-explanatory.
It is.
Yeah.
Say so.
Yeah. But sure. Why don't you tell us? Yeah. We it's something.
It's a mailing.
It's a mailing service, right? Okay.
It's a 3-year contract. You're saving money basically by the 3-year going off to 3-year contract.
Okay.
This year we're saving.
The next one. All right. That IFP 2019-18 for one underground utility vehicle. The trade-in to be awarded to Minuteman Trucks, Inc. for $168,225, 0 cents, pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 164, Section 46D, on the recommendation of General Manager. 56D, sorry.
Okay.
That's what I said, didn't I?
Yep. Second. Second. Yeah, why don't you, so go ahead.
Okay, this is the underground utility vehicle that, you know, we use for line construction. And we are basically, that's a Chapter 164 bid. We send a bid to nine bidders, and only one responded. They took one minor exceptions. These are for the hinges and minor exceptions, which are acceptable to us. And pretty much that came out to $168,225.
After the
trading, yes, we're trading
so
the truck.
There's going to be a truck traded here.
Yeah, that's right.
We're not going to put up a bid or anything like that.
No.
Straight trade in.
Straight trade.
We're not going to relive a bad piece of history.
No. This is going to be traded, yeah.
So then it's okay that you just got the one bid.
Sometimes that happens. I mean, we put it out in, you know, out on street, and we actually send a bid, call the people. Inviting them to participate. And
why don't they participate?
I have no explanation. Maybe that's a busy time of the year for them. Maybe they don't make those, to the specifications. They don't, you know, because it's a custom made. We need it because this is the tool for us in order to be able to do those underground projects that we need to carry everything. And this is number of utilities that, you know, they're using the same basically style truck, and we for improving the, you know, for efficiency and, you know, the being cost effective, we wanted to get the same type of utility truck, underground utility truck.
I'm not sure if you said it, so did we only get one bid
we got one bid, and then that was the only, if you see the analysis on the next page, it was a Minuteman Trucking Corporation. That was the only bid that we received.
Okay, you're comfortable with this?
Lots of them, they don't want to involve the other bidders. They don't want to involve in retrofits and, you know, making custom made. And either they're going to have to send it to other contractors or subcontractors in order to do that, and they just don't want to deal with it.
This is the budget for this is $200,000, and it came in at $168,000.
Yeah.
It came in
originally when we
budget.
Yeah, we asked for that, they asked, they told us, like, well, all this truck is really custom made, it's going to drive the cost up, and that's what we went based on what we were told.
Yeah.
It came out lower.
Good.
Ready for a vote?
Yep.
Okay. All in favor?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Four. All opposed is zero, so that passes. Okay. Move that IFB 2019-19 for customer parking lot improvements be awarded to Edward Page Corporation for $208,469 pursuant to Mass General Law Chapter 30, Section 39M, as the lowest responsible and eligible bidder on the recommendation of the general manager.
Second.
Second.
So the only question I have is how many bids did we get for this project?
Oh, we got 20. We got 20. We sent 20. And out of the 20, we got again we got two bids.
Okay.
And one of them took exceptions. They're actually the lowest responsive bidder. But we decided to go with that because the exceptions that he took was a minor exception.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this project has lots of, you know, benefits for the town, for RMLD, for employees, everybody. That's increasing the spaces from 11 to 17. We're going to have two spaces that are going to be dedicated for the EV charging stations.
Yep.
And two spaces will be dedicated for handicap parking. Then the remaining is going to be for customers and employees.
Yep.
And this is covering all the parking lots here?
No. It's the
let's not forget that we also have a rental. We have the whole credit union. So it provides not so much employee parking, but customers and our rental property as well. And resurfaces the asphalt that's collecting water, and we have drainage problems and issues there as well.
Yeah, and it's a beautification move for the town of Reading. There's a lot of nice things happening in the town, and this is another one of them that we're taking care of. So it's a very nice project.
It is.
I was initially skeptical, but once I really looked at it, I realized this is a great project for the town.
I'm hoping that, if they do economic in this area and there's any kind of a rail trail or anything like that, we have future stanchions for EV heads, should we find that the economics are there for it, that it could be a parking lot for being able to, I don't know that they'll put a train station in, but maybe there'll be a walking trail or something.
Yep.
It'd be great.
That would be great if there was some walkable things happening in the downtown. So we've had a second. And
you had a second.
So we're ready to vote.
Okay.
All in favor? And all opposed? Passes for 4-0.
Thank you both
for advancing that project. It's parking lots looked like
it's going to be done
kind of not great for decades, and it's going to look great now. So that was kind of going above and beyond. So thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yep.
Good.
Where are we now?
General discussion.
Okay. I think we've had a lot of that already.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, so I think the October 17th is fine, and unless anybody has any objections to that meeting date, the only change we might do is if some of these, whether the budget or the town payment study might necessitate some meeting that we could deal with some of these on a different date or an additional date. We'll communicate with everybody on that. Other than that, Phil, are you good to cover the Philbrook CAD meeting?
Yeah. Yeah. When is that? They're going to be the same night as October 17th?
That's the plan, right?
I don't think so because you guys were talking about something different. 23rd or something?
Yeah.
It was the 23rd.
Okay.
Because they have to do it.
Either date is fine.
They have to do it in Wilmington.
Yeah, it'll be in Wilmington too.
Okay. All right. Just Tracy will.
Do you know what the November date is? I think we're trying to back it up with you guys.
Okay.
Yeah. Same. It was just because of the budget we couldn't do the next one. So we had to be out of town.
That's fine.
Okay. So we good? We good to go into executive session?
Yep, I'm good. I move that the Board of Commissioners go into executive session to consider the purchase of real estate, to discuss confidential, competitively sensitive, and proprietary information in relation to making, selling, and distributing electric power and energy, and to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, and to return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Okay. Second.
Second.
Double rock aye.
Ms. Pacino, aye.
Stacey, aye. Thank you, everybody, for your attendance and patience.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
Continue.
Continue.